I just pray as the Perkins come and speak that you would just be able to speak through them to us and that we would all be able to take something away from what they're speaking to us about. And I pray all this in your name. Amen.
What's up, y'all? Good morning, Brass Christian. What's up, y'all? Good morning, Brass Christian. Man, y'all look so good in your prom pictures. Everybody was beautiful. The guys were pretty handsome. Let me pray for us. Father, thank you for this beautiful day. We love you. We give our lives to you because man can't deliver. Lord, the Republican Party, the Democratic Party, Wall Street, man can't deliver. So we don't put our hopes in those things. We put our hopes in Jesus, who is the author and perfecter of our faith, and who's preparing for us right now. Jesus, you are preparing for us a home in heaven. So we can't wait to get there. I can't wait for you to come back. But until then, help us to live as Christ. We know to die is gain, but help us to live as Christ. So Lord, these words would just sow seeds in these kids that are like our own kids. We love them, and you know that. And I pray for these kids all the time. We love you and thank you. And Lord, let your will be done through this today. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. So we actually, Denise and I found out last night about 8 o'clock that we were talking at chapel today. And so, not by the administration's fault. Our family had committed to do it, but through some strange things, one of our family members was going to do it, and that person could not do it. And so we said, hey, we've got it. I'm going to come stand by my beautiful wife, my better half, for sure. This is Nisi. Everybody say hi to Nisi. She's, man, the love of my life. All right, so we found that out. And I thought about this morning. I was like, you know, when Jesus gave the Sermon on the Mount, he didn't like flip through a bunch of note cards. He wasn't like fumbling through his notes, right? He just, out of the overflow of the heart, the mouth speaks. And that's what he did. He just overflowed from his heart. So we're going to share our story today. And some of you know a little bit about the fact that Nisi has had to deal with cancer, but we want to share our story. And the reason why we want to share our story with these beloved is because we pray for you all the time. You're like our own kids. Like, I'd claim any of you. You can come. We have 2 extra rooms because Chloe and Phoebe are already at college. So if you need to come stay at our house, come on. We've got extra bedrooms. I pray all the time, every day, for my kids' friends. So Jackson, Kathy, I'm praying for you because you're one of Isaiah's buddies. Most every day. Like, your specific name comes to my mind. And like, I'm looking out there, and I'm like, oh, man, would I claim Annie? I claim you, Annie. You can come stay in that extra bedroom, Annie Reed. The Reeds, raise your hand if you think the Reeds are the sweetest family on the face of the earth. Thank you. Everyone pretty much is raising their hands. So I'm claiming all of you. So what we're going to do is we're just going to let out of the overflow of our hearts, we're going to let our mouth speak today, and we're going to tell you our story. But before we do, I want to read a scripture because God's word does not return to him void. So I'm going to read a scripture about suffering. You know, this theme this year is about gritty faith, is about community. And I'm looking on the stage and I'm seeing Saul Seabolt. And I've been to Honduras on medical missions with Saul Seabolt. And I'm seeing Pulnick, and Pulnick's dad reads Denise's brain scans and her MRIs. I mean, we're all interwoven. Hannah Gill, I'm praying for the Gills every day. We're all interwoven together. Ryan, Reed have been to my guys, college guys, Bible study at my house. We are all interwoven. We're all in this together. We're community. And that's great news because we need each other. We are weak. We are weak. And we need the strength of each other to be stronger. And so I'm going to read something about identifying with Christ in his suffering today, and then we'll tell our story. This is from Philippians 3. It says, I want to know Christ, yes, to know the power of his resurrection. And we're all cool with that. Like Easter Sunday, we're all great with that because the resurrection gives us all the hope we would ever need. But then the second half of this is hard. I want to know Christ and the power of his resurrection and participation in his sufferings. You know, so many of these speakers, I know the one last week, told you about something hard that happened in his life. And we always tell you guys, something hard is going to happen in your life. And it may be at your age, a heartbreaking loss on the football field. It may be something like that. But some of you know hard things already. You've had a grandparent that was close to you die. You've had your parents get divorced. You're struggling with some deep, dark sin that you don't want to tell anybody about. You're all off in it, deep all off in it. Life gets hard. And the Bible says to identify with Christ in his sufferings is actually God uses those sufferings to make us stronger so that we can help somebody else and comfort somebody else when they've suffered. So suffering is weird, but we should like run to suffering. We should like embrace suffering. That's crazy. Who would want to do that? But that actually makes us more like Jesus, because then we can comfort those who inevitably will suffer next to us. So we're going to share a little bit about our story today. And I want you to go first.
I wasn't expecting that, because he's the gifted speaker and I stand beside him. But I'm not going to cry all of it. So I feel like I'm behind this whole thing. In 2013, I was totally healthy. I just ran a half marathon and life was good. We had just opened a business and a physical therapy clinic. Life was good. And all of a sudden, something wasn't right. So I went to the doctor and they immediately diagnosed me with breast cancer. That was in 2013. And to put in perspective how long ago that was, there's a picture. The next picture shows the guys you know, Isaiah and Jude, and that's how big they were when this first got diagnosed. So now they're all big. So this is how long we've been battling, 9.5 years. And so I had breast cancer, went through all that, and chemo, and lost my hair, and radiation, and that, on drugs for a long time. But in 2015, I started having headaches. And I could, like, bend over and stand back up, and my head would throb. And I went to my doctor and said, we need to scan your brain. And I was like, okay. So I scanned my brain, and they said, and she called me the next morning, said, you have a 4-centimeter tumor in the back of your head. We need you to go to the doctor right now. Dr. Hoover, he's going to look at you. And actually, we're admitting you to the hospital. You're going to have surgery tomorrow morning. So here I was.
Well, they said tonight, and we're like, can we at least go tell our kids?
Yeah, we decided we wanted to tell the kids. And put up Christmas. It was in November, so I'll be like, let's put up Christmas right now, because I don't know if I feel... Anyways, went to the hospital, had surgery on my brain, and it was indeed breast cancer that had spread to my brain. So...
Well, immediately, whenever there's... at stage 4, right? Stage 4 cancer means that it started somewhere, and it went somewhere else. And so when Dr. Hoover...
Another organ.
When Dr. Hoover came and told me, this is breast tissue, man, I just crumbled. I mean, because the stakes are all of a sudden, I mean, it's breast cancer is bad enough. And she had gone through, I mean, her hair fell out. And it was interesting because Chloe was old enough to understand what was going on. Chloe was 11 when she got diagnosed. So we were in this weird way. You try to make cancer like, we got this. We're going to get through this. And you almost try to make it, like, more lighthearted when it's so heavy-hearted. And so we were shaving her head out on the front porch because her hair was falling out because of the chemo drugs. And Chloe didn't want to go outside. She was peeking through the window because she was old enough to understand. These little guys, they're out there shaving their mama's head because they were young and they didn't quite understand the full extent of it. 2015, when she starts having these intense headaches, the doctor was like, we need to take this out tonight. Like, you need to go be admitted right now. And we were like, can we at least talk to our kids? Because when troubles come, they don't come conveniently. Like, nothing... When there's a hurricane, you can't plan for the last 5 weeks. We've been planning for this hurricane. It's upon you. And that's where your faith matters, because either you have it or you don't. So here's the thing. We're telling you about this because you're in training so that when it comes upon you like this, you won't be ready, because it's hard to be ready, but you'll be ready because you know where your help comes from. So in 2015, when the doctor came out and said, this is breast tissue that has gone to her brain and created a tumor in her brain, I just crumbled. Because I knew that it was, like, don't Google that. Right? Like, it's not good. So go ahead.
So I won't go through all the details, but I go through treatment and radiation again on my head. And then and I'm coasting along and I'm on drugs probably indefinitely. I knew that. And then 2018, I keep having brain MRIs. In 2019, they find some more dots, and we're like, please no, you know? And then in 2020, I'm so confused on that.
No, that's okay, yeah.
In 2000. I mean, dots keep coming back, and I keep.
So you're saying dots, cancer.
Cancer.
Cancer keeps showing up in her brain. Yeah.
And so in like 2000, last year, 2022, have to change drugs because these are new spots in my brain, like, and they're worried it's in my brain, in my CSF, which is this fluid that washes over your brain. And so that can make cancer go all over the place. But in 2012.
Let me just add this. In 2020, it hits, and it comes back right before Christmas. And so the kids are opening their Christmas presents while mom's holding a bag to throw up into. And so it invades life. Like it's hard to explain. The cancer is one thing, like fighting the cancer is another thing, but it's all the collateral damage. It's all the other stuff. Like I'm looking over at Isaiah and he's like not wanting to look at mom because she's trying not to throw up as they open her Christmas presents. And Satan is over there, you know, just like, yeah, yeah. Got him where I want him. There's despair, there's hopelessness. You know, his job description is to steal and kill and destroy. So he doesn't want to just give you cancer. He wants to mess up Christmas morning. He don't want to just give you cancer, but he wants Chloe to have this sinking feeling as we're shaving her head as she's peeking through the... He don't want to just give you cancer, but he wants Denise on the first night... She got diagnosed to despair. What did you do the very first night you got diagnosed?
Well, I never have trouble sleeping, but I wasn't able to go to sleep. And I remember laying there with my eyes shut, and I could see the letters F-E-A-R, fear. And I realized, I'm being fearful. And I thought, it's from Satan, because God is not going to make me fearful of this, because I know he has it, but I know it's from Satan. And so I said, in the name of Jesus, Satan, get away. Because I know Satan has to flee at the name of Jesus. And so I just sat there with my eyes shut and said, Jesus, Jesus, Jesus. That's the only thing I knew to do. And I fell asleep. And the next night came, I'm like, you know, thinking of all this stuff going on. And I remember thinking, Jesus, in the name of Jesus, Satan, get away. But then I was like, when I was sleepy, it was in my dreams. The worst case scenario in my dreams. And then I end up just writing on an index card in the name of Jesus, Satan, get away. And I've taped it to my window. So I thought, okay, at least it's being said, or at least it's there while I sleep. Because I knew it was from Satan.
When she slept well.
And I slept well.
And she slept well every night since. That in and of itself is a miracle. Because she gets scans all the time. Like every... What, 3 to 4 months you get brain
eight
scans?
Weeks.
Every 8 weeks, even more so. I've lost track of it. We get so many scans. She gets abdominal scans. She gets heart scans. She gets scans all the time. And there's this thing called scanxiety. You guys struggle with anxiety? Guess what? We're adults. We do too. What's scanxiety, Niece?
Scanxiety, anticipating a scan. I'm all fine and good until the night before scans. And I'm like, I can feel this coming on. It's scanxiety because you're about to have a scan. But I will say in 2022... I mean, I battle this all the time. You know, they're almost changing drugs. So in 2022, they changed drugs again, and I get so sick and have to stop. And they decided to do, I lost 20 pounds. They decided to radiate my whole brain, which that's like last resort. You don't want to radiate your whole brain, your central nervous system that's making you function. So.
Yeah.
I do. And I lose all my hair again, and that's why I have this cool cut.
Really, really cute.
Ryan, yours looks good with curls. Mine, I want to be like Ryan in a lot of ways, like fast and strong, but I don't want your hair. But, you know, from the very beginning, I realized, you know, this is out of my control.
Mm-hmm.
And every day, I have to surrender to God. Before I put my feet on the ground every day, I say, okay, God, I surrender. Because I can't do it on my own. I know that.
Yeah, I mean, So patients are so gracious. My patients will say, how's your wife? Which is super sweet, and they're praying for her. But anytime a patient says, how's your wife? And that happens often, it just reminds me, oh yeah, my wife's sick. You know, when I wake up in the morning and I hear the pill bottle rattling, it's like, oh yeah, my wife's sick. And so you do one of two things with that. Either you just sit on the couch and say, bummer, life stinks. Or you say, like Denise said, this is out of my hands. You know, so often the reason why we get worried, and the reason why we get anxious, and the reason why we don't have peace in life is because we think that we have control. And some of the adults would probably nod their heads when they say you come to a realization at some point that you don't have control. Like, this is so far out of our hands. This is so much bigger than us. And that really was true when God used Moses to part the Red Sea. It really was true when David fought this huge 9-foot-tall giant Goliath. This really was true whenever the stone rolled away for Jesus. All these things are bigger than us. And so whatever it is that you're facing or will face, just know it's bigger than you. Okay? Check. Box. Check.
And I was saying, I didn't interrupt you, but do you believe the story of the virgin birth? I think all y'all would say yes. Do you believe the story that Moses, that God parted the Red Sea from Moses and he walked across on dry ground? Do you believe that? And I think most of you would say, yeah, we believe it. That's the same God. That's the same God that's doing that. Either we have faith or we don't. And I'm choosing to have faith. And I'm not great at all, but I've come to the realization that I'm not called to understand. I'm called to trust. It says, trust in the Lord with all your heart and lean not on your own understanding. I don't understand. I don't understand why I can't be healthy like he does. He is. I don't understand a lot of things. But I trust. It's so much easier to try to trust than to try to understand. Because we're not going to understand on this side of heaven. We just have to trust. So whenever bad things are happening, people are sick, people get hurt, people die, we don't have to understand why. Ever. We just have to trust.
And we get it. Sometimes that's hard. A lot of times that's hard.
Sure.
Right, to trust a God who's unseen, to trust a plan that we don't understand. And that's why the scientists are like, wait a second, you're telling me to trust in something I can't see and you can't prove. And we're like, exactly. And then you have the question for them, okay, if there's no God, who do you trust? What do you trust? The stock market? And it is up and it is down. Politics, it is up and it is down. Man, you look out into the world, everything that you would put your trust in that's not of God is going to fail you. It is fading away. Newsflash, things are corroding, things are rusting. Anything that you put your hope, a person, as much as I love her, she's let me down. As much as she loves me, I've let her down. As much as I love Isaiah, he's let me down. As much as I love Jude. Jude, where are you at? Thank you, brother. Love you. Jude's let me down. Love you, Jude. You've let me down. I've let him down. I've let him down. She's let him down. She's let him down. And we love each other like crazy. I can't tell you how much I love my kids. I was like made to be a dad. I love being a dad. I've let him down. So when God says over and over in the Bible, never will I leave you. Never will I forsake you. When you get into your hard thing, not just when the sun's shining, it's easy to praise when the sun's shining, but especially when the dark skies come, look to the Lord and say, I don't understand, but I trust. That's the seed we want to plant in you today. Because it could be Denise's cancer, or any of you with the things that you face that could be up here telling your story. Or any of the adults telling their story, because they've all faced hard things. We choose to trust. Along the way, God has comforted us. After I read this verse, I'm going to tell you a story, and they're going to put up the last picture, and we'll be done. Praise be to the God and the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Father of compassion and the God of all comfort, who comforts us in all our troubles, so that we can comfort those in any trouble with the comfort we ourselves receive from God. But for just as we share abundantly in the sufferings of Christ, this is Paul saying, we share abundantly in the sufferings of Christ. When we think about abundant life, we think about big cars and boats and lake houses. No. We share abundantly in the sufferings of Christ. That's flipped on its head. People out in the unbelieving world, there's no way they can understand that. And it's kind of hard for you guys to understand that. We understand it just a little bit more because we're a little older, 50. I'm about to be 50, and we've gone through
some
hard things.
I'm not 50 yet.
She's not 50 yet. Let the record show. We share abundantly in the sufferings of Christ, so also our comfort abounds through Christ. I'm going to tell you, he has comforted us along the way. We're going to show you one last picture in a second. If we are distressed, it's for your comfort and salvation. If we are comforted, it's for your comfort, which produces in you patient endurance of the same sufferings we suffer. And our hope for you is firm, because we know that just as you share in our sufferings, so also you share in our comfort. We're going to put this last picture up. Can y'all dim those lights so that they can see it a little bit better? Maybe y'all, can y'all see that? Is that easy enough to see? Yes, no, Ryan, yes? What's that?
Dim
the lights, they said. I just want to make sure that they see this picture. What is that on the back of her head? What's that on the back of her head? What does it look like? A heart. Who thinks it looks like a heart? Raise your hand. Again, just about everybody's hands are raised. So when we're going through these hard things, Denise has had to lose her hair a second time. How was it losing your hair?
I would prefer not to have lost my hair, but it's just hair, and I'm alive.
Yeah.
I mean.
But it was hard.
Oh, it was hard.
Each time they told her she's going to lose her hair, she cried. It's hard.
That first picture you saw, I was wearing a wig because I have these teenage boys I don't want to embarrass because their mom is bald. So I faked it. But.
So it's hard.
It's hard. But what's sweet. Are we?
Oh, yeah, please.
What's sweet is my hair started growing back. And God decided to show me a kiss on the back of my head with a heart. It grew back like that, y'all. The first hair that grew back on my head was a heart. Tell me it's not God. Just saying, show me I've got you. It's a pat on the back of my head saying, I've got you.
Yes. And if we had more time, we would share innumerable stories of that where God just showed up at just the right time. With a heart on the back of her head, her hair's growing in the shape of a heart. There's no accidents with God. I told my friend who I love, who's an unbeliever, we discuss things. And I said, either I live in a world of continual and crazy coincidences, or there's a God who cares and is walking by my side. And why not have the hope that God is walking by our side? And he is. Let's pray. Father, thank you for my sweet wife who outshines me, and that's why I stood behind her. Her humility, her grace, her faith, her trust. Oh, man. It just means so much to me, and I just sit at her feet and learn from her. So help us all to be like Denise. And more importantly, help us to be like Jesus. We trust you, we love you, and we thank you. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
My last one verse I wanted to leave you is, in this world, you will have trouble. You will. He says you will have trouble. But take heart. I've overcome the world. Remember that, guys. Love you, guys.
it's moving all my mountains. This perfect love is casting out my fear. How great this love, oh, it welcomes me like family. And anywhere I go, it meets me there. 'Cause he is good, and he is God. And what I earn is not what I've got. And he is just, yet oh so kind. What I deserve, what could I say about it? My God is love. How great this love. Oh, it's faithful through my failure. This trusted love is with me till the end. How great this love. Oh, it's close than a brother. 'Cause this is love. He died so I could live. He is good, and he is God. What I earn is not what I've got. And he is just, yet oh so kind. What I deserves not what I find. What could I say about it? My God is love. And I know my God is love. And I know my God is love. This is enough to know my God is love. And I know my God is love. And I know my God is love. This is enough to know my God is love. And I know my God is love. And I know my God is love. This is enough to know my God is love. He is good, and he is God. And what I earn is not what I've got. And he is just, yet oh so kind. What I deserve is not what I've got. What more could I say about it? My God is love. What more could I say about it? My God is love. What more could I say about it? My God is love.
I just want to just say thank you to the Perkins family for coming up here and sharing their heart with us. Let's give them one more round of applause. I know that that's tough. It's tough to share things like that, and just getting to know them over the years, just their strength is immeasurable. But their strength is from God, and they know that, and they share that, and I'm thankful for that. Let's pray real quick, and then we'll be dismissed. Dear Heavenly Father, Lord, I just thank you, God. Lord, there's so many people going through so many things, and too many times we want to rely on our own strength, but I thank you that we get to hear stories of what it means to rely on you, God, and even when we're afraid, and even when we don't know what to do, I thank you, Lord, that you're the immovable, unchangeable, and uncorruptible thing that we can truly trust in. And God, to those that don't trust you, that don't know you, and that God, that they don't believe in you, dear Heavenly Father, my prayer is that you would just open their eyes, God, to see that the proof is everywhere, and that the truth is throughout this entire world, and most importantly, it's in your word, and it's just coming out of all the believers and all the people that truly love you and trust you, God. And so I just pray that for those that don't have any hope, that don't have any faith, God, that they would run to you, Lord, when they don't know what else to do. And God, we thank you that we have that, and we have that peace, and we have that that solid rock to really just lean in, God. And God, we love you, and we thank you, and just give you praise and glory for all you do for us. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.